Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs, DRC.
Mimi ni Albert Chingilo.
Abayeho, Waziri wa East Africa, Burundi.
Mimi naitwa Mbaruk Nasro Baruk. Ni naibu waziri wa mambo ya
Uganda. Minister wa Jumuiya ya Afrika.
Umepatia, kuna mjadala tunamoja tumalize, either ni waziri wa mambo ya nje au mambo ya kigeni.
Yes, good afternoon, right honorable. My name is Benjamin Gideon.
Minister of Foreign Affairs, in charge of East Africa for Somalia.
Paya Peter.
Kwamba lazima ajifunze Kiswahili. Jina langu ni Veronica Nduva, ambaye ndio katibu mkuu.
When we get to a meeting, that will do the decision, Raila Odinga. And as the...
Kwa kuongea Kiingereza ili wenzetu wote hapa wasikie kutoka Sudan na kutoka Somalia. Na baadhi. Na ujumbe wao kwa karibu sana.
Unaweza kutumia
hello. Sawa. Bwana mwenyekiti, ndugu mwenyekiti.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Let me first begin by thanking you for giving me opportunity to come and appear before Honorable Ministers of East African Community. Secondly, I want to congratulate our brothers and sisters from Somalia. I'm seeing them here and I know for the first time. And it's a very good news that Somalia has joined the community. So, welcome. Lakini wacha nirudi Kiswahili kidogo. Niseme Kiswahili najua ina historia. Kiswahili inasema inizaliwa katika kisiwa cha Pati kule Lamu. Ambaye ni Kenya. Hapo ndio walianza kuzungumzia Kiswahili kwa mara ya kwanza. Takriban 1000 iliyopita. Baadaye Kiswahili ikatoka kapitia Mombasa ikaingia huko Unguja. Alafu baadaye ikaingia Tanzania bara. Kisha Kenya bara na Uganda na kadhalika. So nasema Kiswahili ilizaliwa Pati, ikalelewa Unguja, Kabalehe Tanzania bara, ikashika ugonjwa Kenya, ikafa Uganda, ikazikwa Rwanda, maombolezi ni DRC. Wanaongea na lahaja ya Kiswahili, yani dialect ya Kiswahili. Kule Lamu naongea Kiamu. Mombasa ni Kimpita. Hapa ni Kiunguja. Ukienda hapo Tanga, Tangati. DRC, Kongo ni Kingwana. Lahaja ya Kiswahili. So, therefore you excuse, but we want to see in the future Swahili becoming a lingua franca, the language of the whole of Eastern Africa. Mr. Chairman, the reason why I asked opportunity to come and appear before you here. Because I know some of you may have heard that I announced that I want to become the chairman of the African Union. And become a chairman of the African Union, you have to be voted for at least two-thirds of the entire membership of the Union. And you also know, of course, that the Council recently decided that this chairmanship need to rotate, and it should rotate regionally. Because before that, anybody could actually come and buy. But that has also brought this disparity. You find that a region like Eastern Africa, for the last 61 years since the formation of OAU, only one person has come from East Africa. That was Salim Salim of Tanzania. We have not had anybody from this side. Most of those who have been there have come from western part of Africa and central. So I think it was very good that they say that now this position should be rotating. And according to the said, it should rotate alphabetically. And this time in Zamu, yeah, a region in Africa, Kanda Africa Mashariki. That African, Eastern Africa will provide the chair and Northern Africa will provide the vice chair. And that's the reason why I offered my candidature. And why do I want to become the chair of the African Union? One, because I'm an African. And secondly, I also think that based on my experience over the years, I have the ability to go to this institution and transform it. African Union, you know, has a history. The founding of African Union in Addis Ababa in 1964, at that time, the clarion call was, first, Africa must be free. So it was formed more or less as a liberation movement to liberate Africa. The second conference, which was in Cairo, the issue of African unity and formation of continental government was very central. If you read what Kwame Nkrumah said, Abdel Nasser, Haile Selassie, Mwalimu Nyerere, and Kadhalika, and so on. But then at that time there were two schools of thought. Those who are saying continental government now, but those who are saying no, you need to go gradually. First begin by building regional blocks. And the regional block becomes the building units to the continental government. That is where there was two different schools of thought. One led by Nkrumah and Nasser. The other one was Mwalimu Nyerere and people like Senghor of Senegal and so on. But that's how the blocks were built. The East African community was informed thereafter. The community thrived for a long time, but there were differences which emerged. As a result of that, community collapsed. I was myself here in Dar es Salaam the day the community collapsed. We had come down here for a conference in Dar es Salaam on East African Airways. Then the following day, the East African Airways could not take off. We had to fly back on Egypt Air to Nairobi. After that, because of differences, the border between Kenya and Tanzania was closed many years. To travel from Nairobi to Dar es Salaam, you had to either go to Addis Ababa and get a flight, or go to Lusaka and connect to Dar es Salaam. People suffered seriously as a result of this. But then, that is history, it's a long history. Eventually, councils of Godwin prevailed, and eventually the community was re-established. And we are here where we are today. But now, regional integration is important as a building block to a continental unity. It's very, very important. But the AU, in my view, is an institution that can do much more than it's doing today. And that is why I want to go there. I was appointed by the current chair of the AU in 2018. As the AU high representative on infrastructure development. And for 5 years, I worked in that capacity. And that enabled me to travel across the entire continent and look at the continent and address the issues of infrastructure. Here we are dealing with issues of Trans-African highways, which includes the Cape to Cairo highway, Tripoli to the Cape highway, Dakar to Djibouti, Dakar to Lagos, Mombasa, and so on and so forth, these highways. And I've seen the challenges of why they're not completed. The missing links which are still there. Then high-speed railway networks in the continent. That is like the one from Beira going all the way to Walvis Bay. Then the corridors that you have here, the Southern Corridor, the Central Corridor, the Northern Corridor, which is supposed to go across, meet in DRC, and we go to Kinshasa. The Lamu Port, Lapset, Lamu Port, South Sudan, Ethiopia Transport Corridor. That is said, should now be extended to go through Bangui in Central African Republic to the Cameroonian port of Douala, to create a land bridge connecting Atlantic and Indian Oceans, and opening up the interior of the continent to trade. The railway line that links from Lagos to Cairo along the coast of West Africa, North Africa, and so on. Then we're dealing with open skies, the air transport across the continent. As you will know, at the moment, air transport is a very expensive thing on the continent of Africa. Because you don't have air traffic control that is centralized. To travel across the continent, you have got to get permits from country to country to travel, which is not a case like in Europe. Europe, they've got one air traffic control, so that once you've got it, you can fly over all those countries to your destination. I'll give you an example. Recently, I was going to the funeral of the president of Namibia, and from Nairobi we will get an, the permit to fly over Tanzanian airspace, DRC, Zambia, Botswana, and Namibia. I spent 3 hours waiting to get clearance to be able to fly. The other time I was in Dar es Salaam, wanting to go to Niamey in Niger. I spent 10 hours in my hotel waiting because I had to get an overflight permission over Uganda, DRC, Central African Republic, Cameroon, Nigeria, and Asia itself. This is what the issues that we were dealing with. To be able to get one continental air traffic control so that you can be able to travel most cheaply and freely on the continent of Africa. Even commercial airlines have to pay this. That's why the air fares in the continent are too expensive. So dealing with this and also dealing with airports, proper airports and runways was an issue that we're dealing with. Then we're dealing with ports, and we're also dealing with fiber optic network that links those capitals of Africa. Then we're dealing with the water transport, the river transport, to make the River Nile, for example, navigable from Mediterranean to Lake Victoria and the Congo and the Gambia and so on. So those are the issues that we're dealing with. They are dealing with issues of energy. Energy is so important for development of the continent. But most African countries are energy deficient. Energy deficient. Yet we have got very many potentials or sources of energy on the continent. The solar is available in most of African countries. You've got wind, you've got geothermal, then we have hydro. Here we were looking, for example, at the Inga in the Congo, where you can be able to generate up to 100 gigawatts in the Congo. And you can then use this to supply most of the African countries. You've got these regional power networks, the Southern Pool, the Eastern Pool, the Central Pool, and the Western Pool. All these interconnected. You can be able to lower the cost of energy because in most of these countries, the cost of energy is so high. Something like a place like the Gambia, energy costs 34 US cents per unit. You cannot do any development with that kind of cost. In most of these other countries, it's over 10 US cents per unit. But you cannot compete with the countries where the energy is something like 3-4 cents per unit. It is possible to bring down the cost of energy on the continent, which will make it easier for the continent to develop. Issue of climate change is a major issue here. And we're talking about compensation because Africa is a victim of this, in this debate on climate change. Because most of the offenders are outside Africa. But you can see the current, how Africa is suffering from this climate change, running from droughts to floods and so on. Now, to negotiate compensation for this climate change requires a very effective machinery at the continental level. so that we can be able to negotiate as one. So then there's the issue of continental trade. Continental trade is a very, very critical issue here. Africa, it has been established states very little with itself. The intra-African trade is just about 15%. Africa trades more with the external world than with itself. Inter-European trade is over 70%. Intra-Asian trade is over 50%, close to 60%. In South America, 35%. But Africa trades very little with itself. Why? One is the issue of non-tariff barriers that have been imposed by these countries, make it difficult to trade. Secondly, issue of infrastructure, which I've mentioned, make it very difficult for these countries to trade with each other. I'll give you an example. Take Kenya and a country called the Central African Republic. Between Kenya and Central African Republic, there's only South Sudan. And you're there. But there's no infrastructure. And so you cannot be able to take Kenyan goods to Central African Republic. To send Kenyan coffee to Central African Republic, you have to get a ship that will sail down the Cape of Good Hope along the western coast to Cameroon, and then by road to Bangui. The Europeans are there much faster than you. That's why they drink Kenyan coffee in Bangui, which is called English breakfast tea. So, but if you open up the continent through infrastructure development, then you'll be able to do this trade, of course. The other one is the issue of security. Peace, there can be no development without peace. So you need peace. The African Union has got what they call the Peace Fund. That Peace Fund has not been properly developed. Some countries made contributions there, but it is still very little. You need to expand that fund so that Africans can be able to deal with issues of conflict in the continent themselves. Resolutions were passed about silencing the guns by 2020. It is just on paper. You still have a lot of guns around. So see how you can use the peace fund to be able to help to bring peace across the continent. That's also one of the things that I intend to promote. So I can go on and on. I know my time is restricted. I just wanted to say that Africa is the richest continent on the planet Earth in terms of resources. It is a paradox that the richest in terms of resources is also the poorest in terms of living conditions of the people. So you can actually make a paradigm shift and change this. You can change this and make Africa also one of the most developed continents. I usually talk of the story of the African lion. And I will conclude with this. The story of the African lion. The African lion is talking to the Asian tiger. Telling the Asian tiger that you, Asian tiger, you have danced for too long on the stage alone. The European bear retreated long ago to the polars. The American panther is also on the retreat. But I, as the African lion, have been asleep in the Congo forest. But now I'm awake, bounded by the mountains of Kilimanjaro to the east and the Atlas to the west. The rivers, the Gambia, the Limpopo, the Niger, the Zambezi, the Nile, and the Congo. I'm surrounded by the African bauxite, African iron ore, African copper ore, African gold, African diamonds, and African forests. And we transform all this wealth, all these raw materials into wealth, and change and transform the lives of my people, and claim the 21st century as an African century. End the story. Thank you.
Na mimi pia nitaongeza Kiswahili. Kwanza nataka tu nimshukuru mwenyekiti wa mkutano huu wa faraga kwa kupeana nafasi kidogo ili mwenzetu Mheshimiwa Raila Amolo Odinga apate nafasi ya kujitetea kidogo kwetu kama mawaziri wa East African Community ama mambo za nchi za kigeni kutoka East African Community. Nataka nitoe shukrani sana kwa niaba yangu binafsi na pia kwa niaba ya serikali ya Kenya kwa upendo wenu kukubali apate nafasi kidogo ya kuzungumza nasi. Jambo la pili, ningependa tu kusema kwamba mkisha msikia, tafadhali mumweke kwa mawazo yenu na fikira zenu ili hivi karibuni labda baada ya ushawishi wote tunaweza kuwa na matokeo mazuri ya eneo hili. Ni hayo tu, na mimi naitwa Musada Mudavadi. Kiswahili si kibaya sana upande ule wetu. Asante sana mwenyekiti.
Chukua nafasi hii kumkaribisha.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, let me repeat once again that we really appreciate that you are able to indulge for this intervention so that the Honorable Raila can make his statement. We are one community. Personally, I can only appeal that please give his candidature favorable consideration based on the issues he has been able to highlight. I also want to say that we will also convey appreciation to President Ruto because he has talked to some of you and also to some of your heads of state. But there's a new feather in the cap, which I can convey that you have also been graceful to listen to the Honorable Raila. So thank you so much to each and every one of you for your patience and your indulgence on this in this matter. Now, on the more friendly note, Later today, because you graduate, we shall host a small cocktail at about 6 within these premises somewhere, as Kenya, just informal, so that the Honorable Prime Minister can also interact maybe on a one-to-one basis with yourselves. And thereafter, we are also happy because the chairman has also organized a formal dinner for us. I hope we shall all be invited.
Yeah, there's we've organized, you know, every day we eat at the same place. We've changed the venue. Today it's going to be special. Elsewhere, the restaurant, outside, band, barbecue. All right, and other staff also will be there for the people who want to indulge in, you know. Yeah, all right. Karibun sana. So from the cocktail straight we go to the dinner. So here we come back at 4. It's going to be a very short session. So we just make it quick, because when we come back, we'll just spend an hour. That's it. And tomorrow we'll start a little bit early, so that we finish when we don't